you know, where this component is, the object repository has it. We just have to use it in our test. So we will see why we really love object repositories. And we'll see how we are using it today. I mean, the way that we are using it, we'll see the norm, that the normal process of using object repository. And then there's a problem. I'll explain you to you the problem, and then I'll give you a solution. And I will try to do a demo and show, and that demo will actually clarify my point even further to you. So, okay, and then we'll have a Q&A session. So these are few of the things. I mean there are more advantages, but these are few of the advantages, very common advantages of using object repository. And it's an auto-generated repository. Usually that's what we use. QTP as test framework and stuff, you get auto-generated. You can sort of pinpoint the object UI and then it will auto-generate the object for you. And then you can use it in a test. Okay. And Selenium, of course, we lack an object repository at the moment. But I think we already have an open source framework for .NET. Platform. So we are trying to work on a Java platform framework as well at the moment. So, but in the future, definitely there will be frameworks available for creating object repositories using Selenium. So they are also the same thing. You generate objects, and all these advantages are there. One of the main advantages, it helps you to keep the logic, the UI logic and the test logic separated. I think I demonstrated this fact in one of the previous presentations on the same in this same forum. Because real advantage of using object repository is that it helps you to sort of keep out the UI related complexities. You don't have to use XParts within your test. Because if you just use XParts and all these identifiers, stuff like that in your Selenium, if you're using Selenium, the way you identify an object is by using XPath, or you sort of have to identify it somehow. But you don't have to clock all these stuff in your test, because your test logic is different from your Selenium. The better you separate them, the better clarity you have. Right? So object repository will really help you to do this. So can you see this slide, guys? So usually this is the way that we normally use the object repository. At least this is how we used to do it. So we have some kind of a place that we can define how the objects. So in Selenium, of course, you can use XML file or Excel file or whatever and define your objects. These are my objects. And then in QTP, there's a separate UI that you can go and define objects. And then once you define the objects, you generate these objects. Right? And then taking that objects, using those objects, you will write a set of tests. And then you will execute and verify, and then again you will write some more definitions. But, I mean, are we all in agreement for this? If someone can tell me they are doing it in a different way, I mean the overall picture. Guys who are using some repositories, is this, I mean, pretty much the way you guys are using it? Of course there will be differences, but if you take the holistic picture, I think this is pretty much the way that you guys are using object repository. But there is a small issue here. Now, the object defining and generation process is not governed by a test. If we follow this path, because the first thing that we do is that we define the objects. I mean, that's the normal tendency, right? When we want to test an application, and when we get the UI, when we are asked to write a test, Selenium or QTP, whatever, first thing we see, okay, there are some objects, so we need to put them in our object repository. That's the starting place. I mean, that's the norm. But then we take that and then we try to write tests out of it. The problem is, your tests, I mean, sort of are governed by the generated objects. But what are you actually testing? As testers, you only test the application. You don't care about the objects. Objects are just tools that you use, right? What matters is actually the test that you write using them. So currently what we are doing is we write the, we generate the objects first, and when we try to write the test based on those generated objects, the tendency is that the object generated generation is not governed by our tests. So what is the consequences of that? What is the disadvantage? Well, for once, your focus is scattered, because usually you write tests, I mean your mindset is should be focused to write tests, not to generate objects. You have to care about, okay, how am I going to test this, not to sort of go and generate certain objects. So then your focus is scattered and you have to shift context. I mean, in QTP and some of the frameworks, it's all integrated, so it's not that so much context difference. But if you are using Selenium, where you don't have a proper object framework available at the moment, then of course it's a huge context, because we have tried this out in our project. Myself and, by the way, those are my project team, those guys over there. So we all actually tried out some stuff with this. We created a sample object repository using Selenium. And the way we used to define objects is an XML. We defined all the objects in an XML. We can do that in Excel file or any other mechanism you want, but whatever the method that we use, what we discovered is that we have to shift the context always, because we have to concentrate on writing the definitions of these objects, and then we have to concentrate on writing tests using those definitions, using those generated objects. And the context switching was pretty frequent, because these tests, sometimes they didn't work because the XPath is wrong. Whatever the identifier that we have put is wrong, so then you have to go and again update that file or the object repository, generate the object again, and come back and do that, run the test again. So it's always context switching. And we all know what that will do. We'll lose our focus on what we are doing. The other disadvantage is, when we generate objects, since the object generation is not governed by the tests, we generate objects that we don't want at that moment. I will demonstrate an example, because, I mean, writing test is a progressive thing, right? But we generate the object repository at once. Sometimes there are objects that we really don't ever use for some reason. Either we haven't written tests, or that thing is not working, some reason. But then it's clogging our object repository. And that object is there, no one knows who created it, no one knows what it does. I mean, it's puzzling. And of course, when we have such objects, then we have to have extra effort to maintain that. And the other problem is, if you really look at one of those generated objects in Java or .NET or whatever, those objects usually have a rigid structure, because it's a generated thing, right? And they are not usually very easy to make compliant to some of the coding standards and stuff like that. But that might not be, I mean, a necessity for most of us. But then that problem is always there. So the main issue that we are having here is that object definition and generation is not governed by the tests. So the solution I propose is something like this. First, you write a failing test. How many of you all are familiar with test-driven development? Have you ever tried it? Writing tests, I mean, doing something with test-driven development? In test-driven development, the main thing is, the development process is governed by the tests, right? So you never write any production classes or business classes without writing a test, failing test for that. The starting point is that. So test-driven development is a vast subject, basically. Maybe we can do a session about it later, some later day. But this should pretty much cover what I want to tell you. So we write a failing test. What we do is, we start writing a test with non-existing objects. Now this sounds crazy, right? How can we write a test without having generated objects? I'll show you in the demo, but for now, just follow the screen. Then we create a manual object. Because this object is, the test is failing. One concept in the test-driven development is that
once the test is failing, you have to stop there and make the test pass. So in order to make this test pass, we have to create something. We have to create an object. So we create that object and we do this manually. Right? Then we execute the test. Now we wrote some test without generating any objects. Let's say we have a object like the Google page. We are writing a test to test Google search. Right? So we know that there should be an object, something like Google page. So we have an object called Google page. And then in this Google page, we have a text box, the search box, and then we have two buttons here. So the Google page object consists 1, 2, and 3. So three objects. Right? But at, for the beginning, we don't generate this object. We don't define this. So just like we just start writing Google page dot get search button or something like that. Get search box or something like that. Then eventually it won't compile or it won't pass because there's nothing existing. So then we create that manually. Okay? And then we execute the test and we make the test pass. What we do is we manually enter the XPath there and we make the test pass. Now, this sounds a bit strange because where's the advantage here? Because we are used to generate, this is the exact thing that we want to avoid by using automated object generation mechanism. We don't want to write this. But if you really think about it, what I'm writing, what I'm putting in that object, in this object, when I'm creating this by hand, is only the things that I want to get this test pass. Nothing more, nothing less. So that will ensure that I will not create any objects that I don't want. Right? And that will ensure that all the objects are used by some test. That there are no objects that is not used by a test. But then, once you do this, if you want to use an automated generation, object generation process, you can do that. How are you going to do that? Now, this is the object definition cycle, or we call this the object inference cycle. Then once we have verified that the test has passed, you can get details from this object and update your object definition in your automated object definition or whatever that you use to create automated objects. Right? And from that, you can generate the objects and execute this. Now, that this is, there's a bit of redundancy here. But that redundancy is for a reason. Because you are creating this object here, and once you ensure that everything is done, everything is working, you will update that object details into your automated object generation process. And you will, from that point onwards, you will generate that object automatically. And then it has been incorporated into your normal test cycle. And that part is actually an optional cycle. Now in this process, since we wrote a test first, before we do anything, this process is entirely governed by the test. The object creation is governed by the test. So, it dynamically creates object as you progress with the test. And it will ensure that all the objects that you use are governed and created because of a test. And for the people now, sometimes you might think that process is a bit tedious. Because now we have to do this manually. But you don't have to sort of create the whole or complete object that you want. In the sense like, you don't have, what you need is a skeleton that will ensure or infer the object that you actually want to create here. This will be more clear when I do the demo. What I mean by this, because we need to ensure whatever the components that resides in an object are used by some kind of a test. Otherwise, it's really difficult to maintain an object repository, and it will clog, and all the disadvantages I talked about will come into effect. But if you follow this method, it will really ensure that you have a well-maintained object repository available. So I think before we go to the demo, any questions? Okay. So I will actually try to demonstrate this by using a demo. And in this demo, I will be using JUnit 4.10. Eclipse IDE, and I'll be using Selenium WebDrive. Are you familiar with WebDrive? Okay, that's great. And of course, I created a set of Selenium support classes in order to do this demo, which will actually help me. Those are not, I mean, essential, but it will actually reduce the number of codes that I have to write. So I'm going to use that, and we are planning to put it as an open source project soon, so you guys can sort of download it in the future, I guess. And the methodology that I'm going to use in order to do this demo is this. This is actually the test-driven approach. Okay. So first, we will write a failing test before writing any object definition code. As I mentioned earlier, that's the first thing we are going to do. And then we will ensure the test is failing, and if my code is not compiled, that means it's failing. Obviously, I can't write it. Right? And then I will write only the object code that is required to pass the failing test. And then I can actually demonstrate how I will infer the minimal amount or the minimal amount of code that I want to create my object. And that will happen in a natural way rather than we first going and assuming and generating some of this. It will happen in a very natural way. Okay. See whether I can. So you guys please ask me any questions if you have in the meantime. So I will briefly describe this test. It's the JUnit test. And before I do anything, I'm going to sort of initialize the web driver. That's what I'm doing here. And I have in my support class set, I have something called browser driver provider. So that is used to provide the browser driver to my object classes. Right? It will provide the browser driver for my object. So they can take that driver and do whatever they want, like send keys, click, or whatever. Right? And then I will sort of, in setup, I will open Google. That's all I'm doing. So there's nothing complex here. And my test is empty at the moment. And after the test is done, I want to sort of quit my driver. So that will destroy the driver and quit the browser. That's all it does. So if I just run this again. Okay, so it does nothing, it just opens Google and closes it for now. So now what do we want to do here is very simple. So my objective is to test whether Google can do a search. phone, not rather Google can do a search, whether it can go to the search result page actually. A very simple test. Because given the time that I have, I can't do anything more complex. But the concept is the same. If you can understand this, of course you can try to apply it to other scenarios as well. The same same concept applies everywhere. So, as I mentioned, now I don't have any objects or anything, so I'll create a Google page. Now, obviously, there's no Google page, so my compiler complains that there's no Google page. So, I can create a class. So, for now, what I do is, I will create a simple class inside the same source file. Copy and paste. Or rather, I can leave it here because some of you guys can't see in the background. And I want this to extend. Now, I told you that I have created a supporting class set. So in that supporting class set, I have a class called Selenium Object, which actually turned this Google page into a Selenium Object. So I just imported this Selenium Object, that's all I did. Before I continue, guys who are coming from .NET background, done any engineering programming? So if this is, I'm using Java here, as you know, but the same concept applies, right? In Unity, it's nothing different, much different. Now, I want to sort of, here what I want to do is, take the search box and put some values there and press the search button. So in order to do that, what I'll do is so I don't have input box yet, but I'll create it. So here again, I can easily create this with Eclipse. Here's the class. Again, I'll turn this into a Selenium object. Please ask questions, guys, if you have anything up here. And I have a method in my Google page to get the search box. Inside my Google page object, I can create the search box. And inside the Google page object constructor, I can sort of say what this search box is. I can initialize the search box. And in WebDrive, how we identify an element is using the PI object. You guys know that, right? Using the PI object in WebDrive. PI, I can identify PI name. So now I have created this object, the input box object, and I have my Google page object. And inside this Google page object, I have a search box. And I have a method to get the search box. Right? Don't worry too much about the exact syntax. I know it might not be, you won't be able to understand it by just looking at it. I will share this project with you so you can take a closer look at it, because I can't go through everything within the short presentation time I have. But what you want to understand is, now I have two objects. I have the Google page object, and I have inside the Google page object, I have the search box, and I have a method to take that search box. Now if I just, I can send some keys to Google search, Google search box. I would say, let's see whether this works. I think that goes too fast. So in the search box, it's typing Selenium Meta. Now, I can of course use the create another object for the search button, and then simply click on that button and do the search. But I won't do that, because I just want to take some time to explain to you about what we have here. Let's go back to the slides. Now we have written a test. First we wrote a failing test, right? And we didn't have any objects in our repository. And when we wanted to create the objects, we just simply created them inside the same class. And if you look at the Google page, now if this is what your test, if let's say that your objective is to test this, right? Your boss comes to you and say, okay, this is all I want to do. All I want you to do is just type something on the Google search page and test that. But if you just sort of look at the Google page, Google home page, there are many other objects other than the search box and the search button. There's an unfeeling lucky object, and then there are so many, many items and stuff like that. So if you just start by, without thinking about your objective, without thinking about the test that you really want to write, you would probably convert all of these things into a object. All of the things that you really don't want at the moment. What you really want is true objects. Simple true objects. And you're done. And my recommendation is, if you're working on smaller projects, if you're working on, let's say, small web applications, by following this approach, will really give you an understanding about what you are testing, and it will keep you focused on what you are testing, rather than worrying about what are these objects and stuff like that. And by using a support class set like ID, I can simply convert anything into a Selenium object by simply extending the Selenium object class I have. So it's a supporting class, right? You need to have that, otherwise it's a bit difficult. So that's why I'll of course share this with you. So if we have something like that, it is easier. Rather than going and generating them everything at once. So we wrote the failing test. We create a manual object. Now if you really look at this object, it's very basic. Actually sometimes, let's say the guys who are doing QTP, I mean this is not the way you create an object. This is JUT. But this object tells you what exactly you want to create in the object that you are going to create in Qt. Just a search box, that's it. It will guide you to create whatever the object that you want to create in your automated object generation tool or what, right? That is the inference. You infer the information out of a method like this. Because since everything is governed by the test, you stay really focused. And you really don't scatter your focus or anything. You really focus and write the tests. Right? I think that's all the time I also have. So any other questions? I know the concept is a bit sort of advanced. It's a bit difficult to grasp. But if you have any questions, I can help you to understand it even more. Yes. Yes. This input box? This X-Part? No problem, because usually, now for the ease of this, I created this inside the same class. But what I would properly do is to create this in a separate class. Now I can show you the structure.
No, but should be the method of updating the...
You can update it now. If you are using this method, but if you are converting this now, that's why I have this optional part. Once you infer the objects, you can of course go and update your automated object repository. In that case, you use the automated object repository. In your tool, I mean, if you are using QDB, then you can make it in QDB. Selenium, of course, currently we don't have a proper framework to create objects. So that's the problem that we are trying to address here. Selenium, what you can do is, once you have created this, now let me show you the my projects. Now I have something called object repository there. So I would actually create this class. I would ask my Eclipse to create this class here at the time that I would have created this class, created this object. Then I know that everything is there. All my objects are there, organized in packages. So, I can quickly go and update it there.
How do you organize the
plane? Yes. So, how do you make it to 100 pages? Now, we also had the same issue. In our project also, it doesn't have 100 pages, but it has a lot of features to be tested. So, we tend to sort of organize them in packages based on the feature. Like if it's logging, we would have a package call, whatever our company name, dot login, and then have all the login related objects there. Then we know exactly, okay, login, we can have that.
So, when you say
that
every time the login,
let's say
the login changes,
yeah.
Still you need to go manually
update them? In this Selenium case, yes, at the moment. But then there are mechanisms, like for instance, we have created, as I told you, we have created XML based thing. So in there we just change the XML file and then objects will be automatically generated and then you can use them. But the problem there, I'm not against using automated object repository. My problem is when you are first going and creating objects in the automated object repository, you are losing focus about the test. So have the test infer the objects that you want to create there. And then create them the way that you used to do. That's no issue. Right? But at the moment, the problem that we are facing is that because it actually happened to us when we were trying to do that. It was really a big problem because we had some objects that we really don't want and sometimes our focus was scattered, so things like that. So that's why we came up with this mechanism. If you really let the test govern the way that you want to create your objects, then it will tell you what the exact structure of the object you want at that moment. Of course, if it changes, you can go and update your object. How you do it, it's up to you. You can. If you really think about it, it's really not that difficult to go and update the XPath in a Java class. I mean, if you know exactly that this is the object, if you properly organize it, okay, my packages are in login and this is the object that I want. It's as same as going and updating your QTP or your XML. And come to think of it, if you really are working, I mean, if you are really writing JUnit tests in Java or JUnit tests in .NET, you have to learn two technologies to do this, right? You have to learn some other mechanism. I mean, Selenium case, you have to either, you have to know exactly how to update the Excel file or the XML file. But if you are using a Java class or a .NET class or C Sharp class, whatever, to maintain this, it's the same thing that you do. You just go and update this file. And you do it once. When it changes. But important point is you never touch your test. The test is already there. You always have that separation between tests and the objects here as well. The reason I think you got confused is because I created the test in the, inside the class. I did that because I needed to move fast. Of course, I would organize them in a proper separate way. Any other questions?
I think we can take about another 2 or 3 questions.
Yeah. I can provide some more features. For instance, in this framework we have something called we have something called the browser driver util. Now it has some functionalities to sort of easily you can write the wait conditions. Otherwise, in WebDrive, you sort of have to do a lot of stuff to wait for an element to appear. When you are doing tests against Ajax-based applications, you have to click something and wait for that element to appear. So we have abstracted some methods where you can simply send the expectation that you want and it will wait and wait for the timeouts and things like that. So it's just an abstraction layer, nothing much. Sorry? This is WebDriver. I mean, this framework that I just did is Selenium objects and stuff, it's something that we created. Actually, the concepts are, I think, they are very similar. If you really look at it, it's not that different, yes. But our abstractions are different. We don't sort of identify a page object, we identify individual elements. So it's a two abstraction levels. So basically what I think you should understand from here is the concept of, rather than creating the objects first, you have to create the test first. So it's bit to the other side. So if you can do that, it will really help you to identify what are the objects that you really want in the list.
Okay, yeah, what you exactly, it was instead of converting the page into objects, you just need what you want, right?
Yes.
Because if you convert that into objects, so it will behave kind of garbage objects that we don't use, right?
Yes, depends on the way that you read it, yes. That's exactly something, yes. But the reason is, it's governed by the test. So everything that we write is because of a test that we do. It's not because our tool tells us to, or it's forced us to. So then, for the guys who are using the tool, they can actually get an idea, okay, this is how I should create my object using the tool, not the way that the tool wants me to.
Sometimes we may get confused with some of the actual objects, right?
Yes, exactly. That's one of the disadvantages in relying on this. But of course, I mean, having an object repository is essential. Otherwise, I mean, you can't do this manually. Like this, if it's a large application, you have to have an object repository. But the main thing is you have to have an understanding that all the objects are there because of a test, and every object has a purpose, and no best way to determine it other than governing it by a test. That's the way even now we write code. I mean, we test driven development, if you just read about it, if you haven't heard about it, it's TDD. So it's really, really changing everything. I mean, it's really changing the way the agile community works, because you of course have to govern everything by a test, otherwise you don't even write a single piece of code.
Most of the time it saves a lot of time, right?
Exactly.
Because
it can save you time. I mean, definitely.
We also had the same issue. We just needed what we wanted.
Yeah, we also had this issue because our object repository actually grew. Since we used XML, we organized them into, as you mentioned, for the login we had different XML, for other areas we have something called data loading, for that we had different XML. But then we had a bunch of XML files, and it was really messy. If you can go and look at it, it's really messy. So even if you use something like XML, I mean, you can come up with ideas. I mean, even QTP, if you look at the QTP object repository, you'll get a headache. So it will pretty much clog everything if you just create objects at the first. Govern it by a test, that's all I'm suggesting. Then you know exactly what you are creating. Okay. Any other concerns? So you can just share what you think about it. Maybe whether it's applicable to your work, things like that, you can discuss. Okay then, thank you very much. Basically, I think Ishan will tell you more about this. We will be putting this as an open source, this simple framework. So you can sort of play with it and see whether it can be a help you. Currently we have this in Java, but the concept is there, because you can create .NET and stuff. So thank you very much.
Okay, thanks a lot, Suren, for the presentation. I think you all would have learned this new methodology, how to discuss the test and then how you can develop your test script. So that's it. We are planning to have the security meetup next week. Most probably, we will have a video call conference with the application security manager, Mozilla Firefox. And still is not confirmed. Anyway, within a couple of these days, we will write that circuit. And so, since you guys are learning what are the new technologies, we can. Last year, we had a video call conference with the Selenium peer, Jason Hackins, and that was a very successful session. That's it. And anything else from the. Session that we should do for the next. Okay, so then we'll wind up the session, and thanks for your participation.